Well, good morning. I want to welcome you to Eastside Baptist Church. We're all experiencing something a little different today. I'm here in a practically empty sanctuary. You're at home. You're either watching us live on Facebook, or you're going to be watching a recorded service here in just a little bit on our website. However you are viewing us today, welcome to our service. By the way, normally when I begin a service on a Sunday morning, I like to welcome our guests. If you're a guest online, you can go to our website, and there is a link on our website that says, I'm new. And if you're just viewing as a guest, you can fill that information in, and there's even a place for you to post a comment or ask a question, and we encourage you to do that. Gives you an opportunity to interact with us. Maybe you do have questions about what our church is doing these days. Maybe you have questions about the Bible study this morning. We want to be available to you to help, certainly in these days. So again, let me say welcome, and we'll begin shortly.
Good morning, everybody. Let's all join our voices and praise together. We find strength to face the day.
you to go ahead and take your Bibles and find Matthew's Gospel. And when you find Matthew's Gospel, go ahead and turn to the end of the Gospel, Matthew chapter 28. And here in just a moment, we'll be taking a peek at some familiar verses, what the verses that have come to be known to us as the Great Commission. Now, while you're turning there, let me just remind you, this year we have been focused on one question as a church. That one question has been what? How do I see? And so we've been thinking as a church about 2020 and thinking about our spiritual vision. And so we've been asking ourselves since the very first Sunday in January, how do I see? We began the year asking ourselves, how do I see myself as a believer? We transitioned to ask ourselves, how do I see my church? And then recently, we've been asking ourselves, how do we see our world? And over the past couple of weeks, as we focused on the world, we've been reminded of several things. We've been reminded, when we think about that question, how do I see my world? We've been reminded that our world is a place that God loves. We focused on John 3 a couple of weeks ago and talked about how God so loved the world. A couple of weeks ago, as we focused on our world, we were reminded from Psalm 19 that our world is a testament to God's presence. David tells us in Psalm 19 that the heavens declare the glory of God. David tells us in Psalm 19 that day to day pours forth speech. And so we dealt with those verses. Just last week, we were reminded, as we think about our world, that our world is a place that needs good news. And so we looked at a few verses from Romans chapter 10, where the Apostle Paul reminds us that those who call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Well, this morning, as we continue the series and draw it to a close, we're going to look at these verses in Matthew chapter 28. And so I'd like to go ahead and read the final few verses of Matthew 28 to set the stage for our Bible study time this morning. Now here's what Matthew writes. But the 11 disciples proceeded to Galilee, to the mountain which Jesus had designated. When they saw him, they worshipped him, but some were doubtful. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Now, as we look at these verses today, and as we think about that question, how do I see my world, what we discover here from the very words of Jesus himself is this: our world is in need of disciples. Our world is in need of disciples. So I would like to pray, and after I pray, we're going to see two ideas that surface from this text. The first idea is this: we see the basis for the command that Jesus gives, and then secondly, we'll take a peek at the actual contents of that command. But let's go to the Lord together in prayer. Well, God's kind of an interesting day for us. As we think about our response, as we think about what's going on around us with the virus, as we seek to think about new ways to transmit the same message, we thank you for technology that allows us to share your word through different venues. And so we pray for our time together today in Bible study. Now, Father, as we open your word, we pray sincerely that you would open our ears and help us to hear what you would say. Thank you so much, Father, for your word. Thank you that we can study it together. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, first, we see the basis for the command that Jesus gives. So, in other words, what's the foundation? Jesus makes this statement, gives a command, make disciples of all the nations. And so as we think about that command, we see in these verses the basis or the foundation for that command. What is it? Well, that can be answered in two words, the resurrection. The resurrection gives the basis for the command that Jesus makes. Now, considering the context of the verses we read, if we went back to the beginning of Matthew chapter 28, we would read the description of Resurrection Sunday. In fact, let me just read a few verses to remind you. In Matthew 28, verse 1, now after the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to look at the grave. And behold, a severe earthquake had occurred, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled away the stone and sat upon it. Now you skip down to verse 5. The angel said to the women, do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who has been crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he was lying. See, because of the resurrection, Jesus is able to make a command. Jesus is able to command his disciples to make disciples of all the nations. So because of the resurrection, we also see another striking statement that Jesus makes. What is that? We'll look again at verse 18 with me. And Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. All authority now is the Lord's. All authority in heaven. All authority on the earth. Now this is not to deny that Jesus had authority during his ministry. If we took time and surveyed several passages from the Gospels, we would recognize Jesus had authority over sickness. We would recognize Jesus had authority over the weather. We would recognize Jesus had authority over other types of physical issues. He healed lame legs. He opened blinded eyes. We would recognize that Jesus did have authority. However, after the resurrection, Jesus has been given all of it, all authority in heaven, all authority upon the earth. It's all his. And based on the fact that he has all authority, now we see he gives this command to his disciples. What's that command again? Will you look with me at verse 19? Go, therefore, and make disciples of all the nations. So we've seen the basis for the command that Jesus gives. What's the basis? He has all authority. And all authority is given to him based on the fact that he was raised from the dead. That's the basis. Now let's think about the contents of the command. The command then. So what does Jesus tell his disciples to do? Make disciples of all the nations. And when you think about that command, there are a couple of questions that we need to ask ourselves. First, what in the world does that mean? What does it mean to make a disciple? It's one thing to read through the Great Commission and think, yeah, we need to make disciples, but it's another thing to kind of think through, what does that look like practically for me, particularly in March of 2020? What does it mean to make a disciple? Well, when we consider that question, it's not like we are in a void to try to think through what the idea is intended to be. We can look at the example of Jesus himself. And if we were to go back and begin to think about the life of Jesus as presented in Matthew's Gospel, we would see a picture of what it means to make disciples. And so if we were to summarize, we won't take time to read all 28 chapters of Matthew's Gospel this morning, but if we were to summarize some of the key events in the life of Jesus, we could narrow our focus to three thoughts that seem to describe what it means to make a disciple. We see what Jesus did with the 12. For example, first, Jesus helped these 12 get to know him. He took 12 guys, he called them to himself, And he began to work with them on a daily basis. And they could see who he was. They could hear him teach. They could see how he interacted with religious leaders. They could see how he interacted with the poor. They could see how he interacted with people of all walks of life. And so Jesus helped the disciples, those 12 guys, get to know him. And part of what it means for us in our day and age to make disciples is exactly that. We have the opportunity in our day and age to help people get to know Jesus in a personal capacity. Well, second, as we look at the life of Jesus as a pattern, what do we see? Not only did Jesus help people come to know him, he helped them to learn to follow him. And so as Jesus taught, not only did Jesus teach crowds, but Jesus taught the disciples. And he had focused teaching for those that were following him. And part of what Jesus helped them understand was the guidelines, the commitment that it would take to walk with him and to follow him in the world in which they lived. And so in other words, part of what it meant to be a disciple was to be a follower of the Lord. And again, in our day and age, we have the privilege, we have the opportunity to help others not only come to know him, but to be a follower of his and to follow him. And to think about what that means for them in their daily lives as they go through what they go through, as they encounter what they encounter, as they seek to walk with the Lord day in and day out. What it means to follow him. Well, there's a third concept that comes from Matthew's gospel as we look at the pattern from the life of the Lord Jesus. What's that third concept? Well, Jesus not only helped people come to know him first, not only helped them to learn to follow him secondly, but thirdly, Jesus helped the disciples develop and mature in their relationship with him. As they watched the Lord, as they heard him teach, they were able to incorporate things into their lives that helped them as they developed their relationship with the Lord. So it was an ongoing learning process as they grew. Now, admittedly, when we read the Gospels, we recognize the disciples did not get everything on the first try. There were some things that they missed completely. There were some things that they did not grasp fully. And it's not until after the resurrection, as you begin to read the early chapters of the book of Acts, that you see that the disciples begin to grasp and practice some of the things that they were taught. And so their relationship with the Lord continued to mature. Their development in the Lord continued to take place even after he was raised from the dead and even after he ascended and took his place at the right hand of his Father. And so Jesus helped the disciples develop their relationship with him. And so again, we have the opportunity as modern day disciples to help believers develop their relationship with the Lord. And so their relationship is to be one of growth and change and maturation. It's to be one that's in an ongoing process of development and gaining knowledge that transcends to the head and goes to the heart as we seek to walk with him. So as we think about the command of Jesus, make disciples, part of what we can see as we go back and look at the Gospels is there is a pattern from the life of Jesus that we can follow. And we can help people come to know him. We can help people learn to follow him. We can help people grow in their relationship towards maturation in him. Well, the next question is a very practical question. How in the world do we do this? Well, again, Jesus helps us know that in these verses at the end of Matthew's gospel. Jesus gives three action words. You guys as a church family have heard me on several occasions talk about participles. And there are three participles that are used here by the Lord that describe a process we can follow that will help us observe and obey the command Jesus gives to make disciples. Well, what are those three participles? The first is the very first word in verse 19. Go. 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 So a part of what it means to make a disciple, not only in the days of Jesus, but in our day, is to go. Now for some of us, that can simply mean going maybe across the street. For some of us, that might mean going across the state. For some, God calls specifically to go to other countries. And so they go to other places to help make disciples of all the nations. But a first component, a first step in the process of making disciples is just that. We have to go somewhere. We have to go to somebody. We're to make disciples of whom? The nations, the peoples. And so we have to go. Well, a second action word that the Lord gives us here that intends to help us as we make disciples is another word, baptize. So verse 19 again says what? Go therefore and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. To baptize. Now the act of baptism was not new in the days of the New Testament. There were other cults and other religious groups that practiced some type of ceremony that was intended to indicate a washing, a baptism, as folks prepared to worship. So the concept of baptism was not new. What was new for Christians in the days of Jesus and the practice that became adopted by believers was to be baptized in the name of the Lord. And here Matthew records we're to be baptized in the name of the Father and the name of the Son and the name of the Holy Spirit. And so we practice baptism. That Greek term baptize literally means to dunk or to immerse. And so we practice baptism. When somebody comes to know the Lord in a personal way, a public act that indicates what has taken place in their heart is the act of baptism, where we immerse somebody, we dunk them in the water, and then we bring them up to new life. And so in the days of the Lord, part of what was intended to help the disciples make disciples was the process of baptism. Well, there's a third word that is given to us here. What's that third word? The idea of teaching. So, Jesus says in verse 20, teaching them. So the nations, those that become disciples, make disciples of the nations, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. So part of the process of making a disciple is to teach them the words of the Master. And so Jesus says, teach them all that I commanded you. So a part of the process of disciple making is instruction. We are to teach others what Jesus has said. We are to teach others what the Bible has said. And so for us, we had various opportunities to do that. Some folks come on Sunday mornings to a small group or a Sunday school class. Some folks come to Sunday morning or Sunday evening. Some folks come on Wednesdays for Bible instruction and for teaching. There are groups that meet through the week, and folks are instructing and teaching what the Bible says to help people know how to live life in our day and age in honor of the Lord. And so, what does Jesus command? He commands that we make disciples of all the nations. How do we do that? We go, we baptize, and we teach. And as the Lord Himself concludes His command and instruction to the disciples, He gives them one reminder. And with this reminder, we close here this morning. What is that? Well, the end of verse 20, after Jesus says, teach them, He says to them, and lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. What a poignant reminder to the disciples. This reminder that He would be with them to the end of time. He was not going to leave them. He was not going to forsake them, even though physically his presence would not be with them. Spiritually, he would not leave them. Well, what a reminder for modern day disciples today that we can count on, trust the presence of the Lord with us. And wow, what a reminder, especially in these days when we face the crisis of the virus, and as we try to think about what it means for us as believers to walk with the Lord and to help others during this time. Well, as we conclude today, again, our focus question has been what? How do I see? And as we've discussed over the past few weeks, we've been thinking about how do we see our world. Today, we're reminded from Matthew 28, our world needs disciples. And so as we think about what a disciple is, we've been reminded of the command that Jesus made, make disciples of all the nations. We've seen the basis for that command this morning. And then we've looked a little bit specifically at the contents of that command. Well, as we conclude, I want to pray in just a moment. But before I pray, I want to take an opportunity while you're either watching live or watching the recording here in a little bit. Please let me remind you, your staff during these days is available to you. If you have a need, you can contact us, and we want to respond to that need. We're available to you. If you have prayer requests, we recognize that we're limited on how we can take prayer requests, but you can send your prayer requests by email. You can send prayer requests through text. You can contact the church. The church office, as I indicated on Wednesday, will still be open for a time anyway. And so you can call and give us prayer requests, and we will pray for you. You can send us your prayer request. And then one final reminder, we will have a Wednesday Bible study. And so we'll be going through this process again on Wednesday, and you have the opportunity to see the next Psalm, Psalm 4, either on our website or through Facebook. We want you to know we love you here at Eastside. We want you to know you're being prayed for, and we want you to know that you are cared for in our community. Let me pray, and we will be dismissed this day. God, we want to thank you for your love for us. We want to thank you for your mercy. And man, Lord, we need your mercy now more than ever during these days. We pray for your grace. We pray for your mercy. I'm praying for my church family. And I ask you to watch over them. And I ask you to keep them in your care. I'm praying for our community. And I'm praying, oh Father, that you would limit the spread of the virus here in our community. God, I pray for our nation, not just our nation, but the world, as national and world leaders deal with various measures to try to slow the spread and growth of the virus. God, I pray today for doctors and nurses that are working overtime to help people. And I pray for your mercy and your grace and your strength for them. God, thank you for the time we've had together here today. Again, I pray for my church family and ask you to watch over them this week. And this I pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.